value from above and from below. So this is what happens. There are two independent branches of solutions. One of them disappears at gamma equal 1. And this is an interesting example in classical mechanics, if you want, because it's 1 degree of freedom, effectively. But it has these interesting applications. Now, the interesting applications, you know, if you have a little bit of feeling, since I'm trying to convince you that at some point we may be learning something about inflation, perhaps, you should immediately spot a contradiction. Because in order to get to the interesting point, gamma should be equal to 1, while in order to drive inflation, gamma should be small. Technically, in four dimensions, should be less than 1 over square root of 3. 1 over square root of 3 is, so it's less than 1. So it means that the model is not a model of inflation. At most, it's a model for the onset of inflation. But there is one interesting point. Although mathematically the problem becomes much more complicated in general, not completely generally, because I will show you that there are examples where I can solve for you exactly the problem using techniques of integrable systems in potentials which are more general. And the type of potentials I have in mind are of the following type, are the following class. I always want, in the potentials of interest, some top-down component which is of this type. Let me take gamma equal 1, which is the case that I will explore directly, plus another potential, V of phi, which will not be under control from top-down, from the top-down perspective, which will be milder. So if you want, what I have in mind is something like this. Something like this. In a region, there'll be variations of the potential, but there will be one exponential wall. No matter what, the exponential wall asymptotically will dominate, and you will see that the solution should be like this. For instance, an example that is of interest is the following. Take the Starobinsky potential. The Starobinsky potential is described in the same kind of setting by a term of the type e to the minus, say, alpha times phi squared. Actually, let me call it this thing 2 alpha, where alpha is small enough in order not to be this exponential wall. And to this term, I will add an exponential wall. So what is the situation like this? So typically, you look at the Starobinsky potential in this region. But if you look at it all the way, in other words, typically, you look at the Starobinsky potential with the scalar approaching its eventual equilibrium point from this plateau. But actually, the Starobinsky potential continues with what we could call a mild exponential on the opposite side, an exponential which is not critical. If you combine a potential of this type with an exponential which is critical, then the type of dynamics that you have, the only type of dynamics that is allowed is the following. You go here, you bounce, and then eventually you settle in the minimum. So in other words, the Starobinsky potential modified by this top-down ingredient allows only one type of dynamics, dynamics according to which the scalar descends, the milder part of the potential, starting with infinite speed, of course, comes from the initial singularity, goes down, goes forward, bounces back, and then eventually it settles down. So if you want, the scalar need not be put by hand in the flat part of the potential. It gets there. Although, again, I should be slightly less pretentious in what I'm saying, because there is a little bit of fine-tuning, because you could also imagine that the scalar comes down and doesn't quite make it to bounce there. The bouncing on this exponential wall will produce interesting features in the power spectrum of scalar fluctuations, which I will look at later on. But the kind of picture that you should have in mind at the end of this lecture is that there is an interesting peculiar behavior of these systems, that this system certainly is not the realistic potential we have to deal with, but is at best an important ingredient that dominates asymptotically for the field space. It forbids certain parts of certain types of solutions. And forbidding these types of solutions determines certain behaviors of the dynamics, which may typically involve some bounces. Thank you. Please. Absolutely, but the solution that goes, the solution that reaches the limiting speed from above disappears because the limiting speed becomes higher and higher and higher. Yes, but you can only approach this infinite value from below. That's what I'm saying. That's what you're saying. So that's why the analogy is here, right? You have a limiting value. There are two kinds of solutions. The ones that start faster and slow down. The ones that start slower, they are pushed by the driving force F, and they reach the limiting solution. Right? In the limit in which this driving, this damping force becomes smaller and smaller and smaller, at some point the solution that approaches it from above disappears. And of course, the other one changes its nature, becomes a uniformly accelerated solution. No. No, it's not there anymore, because if I put the beta to zero, and I cannot start from infinite speed, really, right? That's the.
True, but
that's
the solution, if you write down the little expression,
yeah? Yes, it's a uniform accelerated solution. My claim is that if you look at the exact solutions of this system, which I didn't derive completely, you will find that near the initial singularity, they behave exactly like that. They become, at that point, in those variables, like a uniformly accelerated solution. The only difference is that here, the transition occurs, if you want, when this parameter goes to zero, which is a limit, or one of the parameters goes to infinity, whatever you want. And in this case, it appears at this peculiar value, intermediate, if you want, formally gamma equal gamma. It's just an issue of parametrization. The phenomenon, to some extent, is a relativistic analog of that. At some point, the damping is not effective anymore. That's what happens. Then the Luckey-Mevarese attractor disappears, and the behavior of the solution also changes, because you have only this accelerated solution, which as such cannot reach a limiting speed as pertains to the Luckey-Mevarese attractor in this gauge. That's all. I was just anticipating what I was telling you. No, I was just anticipating some, giving you some flavor of what we can discuss in the next lectures. The point is that when you combine this only top-down part of the story that is solid in our hands with potentials of various types, in particular this one, and then the dynamics becomes interesting, if you want, because here you can only go in one way. The only way you can do it in this case is go down, up, bounce back, slow down, and then eventually go here. And if you are in that.
Yes, I have the following question. Okay. If you start from left, you said, in your model, too slow to go down, don't you have a problem with the slow roll? Then you might exit the slow roll phase before you reach the minimum. In that case, maybe we will see that. Exactly, that's right.